at that point, Andrew said, Jen, I'm on my way to come see you right now. I need to talk to you. And I remember at that moment thinking, that's not someone what somebody says when it's just minor. This has to be serious. So at that point, I said, Andrew, don't make me wait. You need to just tell me right now. I'm here at the gym. I'm not in the car. Just tell me what's going on. And that's when Andrew told me that there had been an accident.
On Thursday nights, it was I would coach the 5:30, and he would coach the 6:30. So I was expecting to see him at the 5:30 class, and he never came in. And then 6:30 rolled around, and I'm calling him, trying to figure out, you know, well, where you at? You know, what's up, where you at, come on. And, you know, I didn't know what had happened or why he didn't show up.
Come on! 28! 29-30, let's go, let's go, let's go! Come on, one more! Let's go! Time!
I met Zach in 2008, in the fall of 2008. I was actually rushing a fraternity, as it were. And Zach was, I was assigned to Zach as my big. So he really was an integral part of my kind of, you know, the formative years of my college experience and really starting to come of age in my college years.
So he talked to me about starting a club. I said, I'll be the advisor for it, but he wanted to, it was a student-run organization. So he took the bull by the horns and started getting set up, and he was the first president of the club, and they would come and work out religiously, and they were the ones who petitioned to get the space down at Belfield, and they start just introducing other people to it. And he's very charismatic, and he'd grab other kids and say, hey, this is what I'm doing, come do it.
What we would do is there were a bunch of bumper plates in Trees Hall Gym, which was in the basement. And, you know, it was very tight, a lot of machines, not a lot of free space to run around and do, you know, box jumps and weightlifting exercises while we're at it.
I was a freshman, Zach was a senior. Him, along with one of the other older guys, Ryan Johnson, taught me a lot about the movements and took time out of their day and their workouts just to teach me and help me through different movements like overhead squat or a proper form for a jerk or a snatch. It's just, you don't get that type of care and personal feeling from many people. No, many people don't take that time to be nice to someone else and take the courtesy to teach.
Because I didn't know anyone at Pitt. I'm from Virginia, so it was like not very many people in my area to come to Pitt. And kind of Zach and like the rest of the guys kind of took me under the wing. Like, he was a big part of the reason I stayed at Pitt, just because he was always looking out for me. I went to sectionals with him 2 years ago, and like, I was a little nervous. I drove all the way up from Virginia, but like, he definitely was looking out for me all the time and went over to his house a couple of times to do workouts and stuff like that.
As soon as I got back that summer, myself and a few of the other guys that were doing CrossFit in Panther CrossFit, we all lived in Oakland, just up the street together, right near Pitt's campus.
301 Coltart. It's, the house has seen better days before and after us. So, but it was a great time. We had our own little setup. We had two barbells, about 300 pounds of weight. In our driveway, we actually made a kettlebell. We actually had a 200 meter mark down the street. It was nice with a flat street. Had a 200 meter mark at a signpost from our driveway to the signpost of 200 meters so we could come right back in for a 400 meter run and whatnot. So it was actually pretty ideal. The relationship between Panther CrossFit and CrossFit Pittsburgh grew from the fact that Mike Pietragallo was a Pitt alum. So, you know, he wanted to support us any way he could. So he opened his doors for us, let us come in, use the equipment, come into the classes. So it was a great relationship that we had built with them.
My wife and I are both alum, you know, at Pitt, and it was holidays. I don't remember which one, maybe Christmas break. Well, we got an email from Zach asking if they could come train at our gym because all the facilities there were closed down for the holiday break. And that was the first time we ever met him, where he and a few of the guys from Panther came to the box and worked out with us.
You would be in the middle of the workout and all of a sudden in the corner of your eye, you would see him doing the Dougie in the corner of the room.
He was like doing a max ever push trick or something. And he hit a PR and he immediately stripped and started shrieking around the room of all the Panther CrossFit members and just started doing celebratory chest to bar pulls. And that was one of the funniest things. That was one of my first experiences with Zach, and I was like, what am I getting myself into here with these guys?
He would look for the most outlandish outfits to wear, like whether it was girls' shorts or just something funny like that. He would do that, but yet he was extremely serious. Like if you talked to him during the competition, even though how he may have looked in his shorts, he was so focused and set on what he was doing.
I think it would be the only way I could describe him. He was driven. I will not speak about him in the past tense, but he was one of the most dedicated, driven athletes I've ever trained with.
We would have great talks before and after the workouts. And with all sincerity, like, he truly wanted to know what it would take to be better and would not stop until he got there.
There was a pop in the gym that was palpable, and it was very difficult for those first couple days because everybody's just asking questions. Everybody's not, there's really no focus on the workout any longer. This, for the first week or so after injury, this wasn't a gym so much as it was a center to come and seek some sort of outlet for your frustrations, for your angers.
Whenever I work out now, I'm like, Zach can't work out. So like, it just in my mind, like I work out for him now. Pretty much, like if I get like tired, I'm just like, can't be bad. Can't be any worse than anything, you know, he's doing.
I'm trying to digest it and I'm trying to find, you know, something good about it, you know, to give me something to hold on to. And the first reports actually were so bad, they said that it looked like he might not make it through the night. Well, obviously he did, you know, Thursday night to Friday morning. But come Friday morning, one of the words that was thrown out there at the hospital was, it may have been better had he not made it.
I mean, it's heartbreaking. It's frustrating to see somebody with so much potential and just vitality for life to be in a coma. It's almost surreal because you can't picture it.
He's full of life. He is, and he affects everybody around him. He really does. At the Mid-Atlantic Hopper Challenge, you know, unbelievable. I mean, I consider Jeff Tincture a friend. He's a good guy, but to take the podium and to turn over your winner's purse like that is incredible. And then to have Christy Phillips, you know, another phenomenal athlete, do the same thing. This kid has obviously impacted people. Zach, enough already, all right? Need you back here, brother. All right, we miss you, we love you, and selfishly, I need you to coach me.
Zach, you're an amazing human being. If anyone's gonna pull through this, I know you can. And I look forward to watching with you again. Might even have a little bit of time where I can keep up with you.
I remember you saying to me, I would never quit, not for any reason. Even if I thought it was coming in dead last, I would never quit.
I'm here for you. We're doing as much as we can to make it easy for you once you wake up. We love you, and just pull through.
So I'm counting on you to push through. We're praying for you and can't wait to see you get back on your feet.